Good afternoon. Thank you very much for joining us on this Facebook Live event. My name is Yi Chun, and I'm a clinical instructor here at the International Human Rights Clinic at the Harvard Law School. I work on Myanmar, and I feel very privileged that we have with us today UN Special Rapporteur on Myanmar, Dr. Yang Hee Lee. And helping me on this conversation with the Special Rapporteur is Ha Yong Jung, a third-year law student who has worked with me on Myanmar for more than 2 years. How about you get us started, Ha Yong?
Sounds great. Thank you, Yi. And thank you very much for joining us, Special Rapporteur Lee. Before we jump into the situation in Myanmar, I thought it would be nice for our viewers to get to know you a little bit better. So can you tell us a little bit about what sort of led you to pursue the field of international human rights and sort of what fueled your passion?
Oh, well, thank you for asking that question. I went into developmental disabilities when I did my doctorate work. And I went into the work of prevention of child abuse and neglect because many of the children with disabilities were being underreported in terms of abuse and neglect, and that's what I went into. And then South Korea ratified the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, and they were going to see if they can put forth a candidate for the committee. And that's how I ended up working for the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child.
Okay, and now you're assuming the role of the Special Rapporteur.
Yes.
Just a difficult position currently. Can you tell us just briefly what does your role entail as a Special Rapporteur?
Okay, there in the UN Special Procedures System, we have what is called a Special Procedures where people, for instance, like myself, who are special rapporteurs, and there's also independent experts. There's also people who are working in working groups. There's a different mandates, but we are all under special procedures. We have 44 thematic special mandate holders, and we have 12 country-specific mandate holders. If you're a country-specific mandate holder, that's all you do is you work on the full range of human rights issues in that country. And we are, by resolution mandate, we are mandated to do 2 country visits per year, produce 2 reports, of course, one to the Human Rights Council and another report to the General Assembly. Working groups and thematic mandate holders do country visits, they report on country visits too, but they also report on their thematic report. I do not have to report on a thematic report. So anytime I would like, or any mandate holder seeks a country visit, it has to be at the approval, at the invitation of the state concerned. And it becomes quite difficult sometimes because they will give you an invitation, but many of the areas that you want to go to is not accessible because they would say it's for your own security reasons.
Okay, so on that note, I think it's a good time to move to our questions on Myanmar.
Yes, so you've worked on Myanmar, Special Rapporteur Lee, since 2014.
Yes.
There are a myriad of human rights issues in facing that country, and I was just wondering, how do you prioritize which areas you focus on, make your recommendations on?
Well, this mandate has been in existence for 22, 23 years, more than that. And previously, it was during the junta period, and then I took over at the very end of U Thein Sein's quasi-civilian government. So in the previous times when my predecessors, they had pretty much focused on civil and political rights, more on political prisoners, more on democratic space, freedom of expression, freedom of assembly and association. Those are the major kind of areas that was prioritized. When I came along, I started to prioritize, of course, the economic and social cultural rights aspect of Myanmar. mainly because, not because the social, the political rights were not that important. I still focus on political prisoners, how many they are, and how many journalists are being arrested, under what charges, what about the democratic space. And I still focus on conflict areas, child soldiers, labor issues, but mostly I've noticed that there's this land issues, the land evictions have been a major issue that permeated across Myanmar.
Right.
And it was in parallel or in the same time when the efforts for the push for development in terms of the country, and building dams, building major residents, major projects, economic zones. So this is what I started to go into a little more. And consequently, I've also looked into business and human rights issues. This past visit, I focused on the mega projects, the socioeconomic zones. So how do I prioritize it? They're always perennial issues that I have to look at. Of course, the civil and political rights, as long as they are still important, the political prisoners. Why are they still being held? Why are some not having legal access, legal aid? Or why are some held incommunicado and summary execution? Arrests and arbitrary arrests are happening. So this is something I have to continuously look at. And then I look at conflict. And with this new government, the major thrust or the focus was on the Panglong conference. Having said that, the last part of U Thein Sein's government was on the national ceasefire agreement, and I was following that too. And I also prioritize states, of course, Rakhine, as long as they have Rakhine issues in Rakhine, I go there. And of course, armed conflict areas like Kachin and Northern Shan or Kayin. As I said, these are the states I would choose, depending on some new developments of events.
Right.
For instance, when I went to Northern Shan this time, there was this event of the Tanai clearance operation, and so it followed that. And of course, the thematic areas I've already planted in advance.
Mm-hmm. I see. And you mentioned Rakhine. I mean, the Rohingya crisis and the devastating images and stories have really permeated our conscience over the last few months. And you've personally visited Rakhine State. You've also been to Cox's Bazar in Bangladesh. And you've spoken to many of the people who've been fleeing persecution. I was just wondering if you could share with us, you know, so what sort of stories have really stayed with you after these really difficult missions that you've taken?
Oh, the January mission, this past January mission was really difficult because it was just after the October 9th and the clearance operation. And I had been granted access to Northern Mongdaw, and I was able to, and I told the government that they need to stay on the roads, not to follow me, because usually that's what happens when foreign visitors or diplomats visit, is that the minders will go in, there's security, and so they're really threatened if they speak, and there has been reprisals, the documented reprisals, and so I was able to speak to the people there, and the stories are same, and it's really burning, throwing people in the house in the fire, tying up people, and burning the place, gang rape, torture, hitting and torturing and looting, taking their jewelry, destroying their food crop, etc. Then when I went to Cox's Bazar, I was able to kind of validate what I heard from the Myanmar side. And you know, you can't you can't rehearse these things. Mm. You can't say to everyone, you know, send a SMS message and say, this is what you have to say. I interviewed about 97 recent arrivals in Cox's Bazar, and I tried to identify a different villages that they fled from. What sticks into my mind is when a mother said to me, when I was running, I was holding my little child and they threw my little baby who was 1 month old into the rice paddy. I couldn't go back to fetch her, and she was really feeling a lot of guilt. Another family was saying that they escaped. They tied up people in the house, they escaped, but thinking that one of the elder children would have grabbed the younger one. Mm. But the child wasn't grabbed, and so she had to go back and fetch her. And then another story when mother said that all of a sudden, it was cold in the morning, and they were making fire, and the security forces came in, and the child was only about a year old, and just threw him in the fire. I have this on my webpage of my special rapporteur webpage. Mm-hmm. There is a link to a Flickr account, which I have. These are photos that I have taken and posted, and it just shows a little slimmer of a little toddler with still burnt scalps, and some are falling off, and a young boy whose the lower extremities has just been, you know, massive burnt scars because the clothes all burnt and onto his body. Yeah. But, you know, these children had still, this toddler still had, you know, kids are kids, you know, they have that bright look, but the little older age they get, you know, it's really frightening. They're traumatized.
We can't even fathom what has been happening there. And recent international attention has been really focused on given all these reports that are emerging, rightly so, focused on the Myanmar State Councilor and Nobel Laureate Aung San Suu Kyi and the next steps that she is taking to resolve the Rohingya crisis. Given that the Myanmar Constitution still ensures that the military is in control of issues such as national security, state law and order, and very little oversight from the civilian government, I was just wondering if you could share with people, what are some of the things that the civilian government, and specifically Aung San Suu Kyi, could be doing despite the constitutional constraint on their powers?
In relation to Rakhine issues? Or
yes, okay. I think in relation to Rakhine, but also just generally on the areas that you see are emerging emergencies for human rights in Myanmar.
Okay, well, we have to remember that there are major issues in Kachin and Northern Shan that is now being neglected or being forgotten because of the gravity of the situation in Rakhine. Mm. People in Kachin and Northern Shan, some areas or many areas, humanitarian assistance has been blocked for over a year. We have a large number of IDPs there. They've been living in IDP camps for 6-7 years now. There is some areas in Northern Shan where there hasn't been any access at all, and birth registration hasn't taken place in about 9-10 years. And these are some things that are really hard to believe. Mm-hmm. The civilian population are really suffering the brunt between the ethnic armed groups and the attack on all the military. So the situation in Kachin and Northern Shan are even as severe, as serious as they are in Rakhine, but, you know, not in this magnitude and horrendous nature. But I have reports of mass graves found in Kachin, villages burned, but not in this great where you have about 288 villages approximately being burnt in Rakhine. So and the people in Kachin and others, they want to have the Dosu recognize this, and they were waiting to have her at least visit the area, which she did. She went to Michino and recently, but in Rakhine, I've suggested that she visits Sitwe, Rakhine, but that hasn't happened. But having said that, she can turn to the people. Yeah. That's her power. Mm-hmm. And the people just adore her. So if she turns to the people and asks them that, you know, we have to stop all this violence. These are fellow human beings and brothers and sisters. So I think then that would give her more of a support, and I believe that could help the military to reconsider if without the backing of the people, would that be possible in this day and age? Mm-hmm.
So, as you've mentioned, the international reporting is very focused on Rakhine at the current point in time. And like you've mentioned, other states or other issues are either being underreported or sort of hidden behind the scenes. So we were wondering if you can maybe expand on whether you'd like to talk more about other human rights abuses that are occurring in the country, or maybe emerging narratives or sentiments being felt by people around Myanmar.
Yes, you know, we have to remember that there are other refugees in other parts of the world from Myanmar, and they have been there for decades and cannot return back. But if they were to return back, what would they do? What kind of documentation? I have talked with the authorities that when they come back, the kind of educational documentations that they should be to be respected. And I think in Kayin area, some have come back, and the local administrators have accepted some of their documents of educational documents. So unless that is mutually accepted, I think it would be not easy for people to come back, because once you have that, then you're qualified for another step. The other areas is, you know, land evictions for the name of development. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the people are not been given clear information, the informed consent. I really doubt that in some areas there has been informed consent. And the environmental degradation that these big projects have caused and will cause, and it's really not sustainable for the people, the community.
Well, I personally thank you so much for, you know, the work that you've done on behalf of the powerless and the marginalized in Myanmar. And you've spoken out on behalf of these communities, and it has had consequences for you. I mean, you, along with other women human rights defenders in Myanmar, have been the target of personal attacks by extremist ultranationalist monks, including Wirthu, because of your work. So I wanted to ask you, when you're confronted with such ugliness and this sort of sexist intimidation, how do you keep going, and how do you not let it affect you?
Well, sometimes when Urartu sends these really vulgar campaign speeches, but, you know, he also incites the people, like, you know, patriots rise up and show this beastly woman a lesson. That's really incitement for some kind of violence. And I get really horrid, vulgar, but really terrifying messages, tweets, and Facebook messages. But my work is not for these people. And then, you know, I have to sit and reflect that, why did I start this first? And then it just takes about 30, 40 seconds for me to just say, why did I start this? Actually, I can't lose sight of why I started this work, and I just move on. Yeah.
That's great. Well, that was a lot of information to digest, and it would be an understatement to say that the current situation is complex and difficult. To hopefully end up on a hopeful note, what can we as students, faculty, staff, and members of Harvard Law School, Harvard University, and beyond do to contribute to Myanmar's transition to a democratic society with rule of law and a culture of human rights for all?
Well, first of all, the young generation have a very effective tool, which is social media. And the Burmese, the Myanmar young population, I think they are very willing and open to have other people from around the world support their work or providing them with the necessary information. And the social network, social media is the only avenue or channel that they can receive this. And I think this is what the young law students could do, young and old law students could do, of course. And the law faculty and others would be really devote their time and some research, but research that will translate into actions and some practical, come up with some practical recommendations. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thank you. Well, we are definitely utilizing that SNS sort of new developments in technology here. Thank you so much for joining us, Special Rapporteur Lee. Thank you also for your dedication for human rights and for the situation in Myanmar. Thank you, viewers, for watching us. Please subscribe to our mailing list. Please follow us on Facebook, leave comments below, and we look forward to continuing the discussions with you offline. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you. Bye.